Hello, everyone. Welcome to another one of our learning sessions. Now, luckily for all of you, I will not be giving grammar tips. No worries about that. But that's why I'm pleased that we have such a fantastic lineup here today. So Sam, Maya, Peter, Anna, welcome. And thanks for agreeing to join us here today and to contribute to this learning session. Now, considering we have only 1 hour and we have a lot of things to get through, and we also want to leave some time aside for Q&A towards the end, let's dive right into it.
Before I ever start writing, I always ask myself, who is the audience? And this may sound stupid, but I will always remember my first meeting with the European Commission when they said, we want to do a brochure. And I said, super, who is the audience? Oh, well, you know everybody. And it's very difficult to write if you don't know who you're writing for. So the first thing I would say is, who do you want to talk to? And even in the EU bubble, there's lots of different audiences, aren't there? We'll come to that in a minute. But you know that yourself, that even here in Brussels, there are a lot of different stakeholders and they all know slightly different things and they all need to know slightly different things. So you have to think about your message. And very often what you might have is a core message and then one or two specific messages, depending on who the stakeholder that you're writing for is. And then very importantly, why are you writing this? When you want somebody to read something, you want them to do something. You either want them to agree or to disagree or to act or to object. You want them to do something. You don't want them to just walk away, particularly here in Brussels. This is an action town. So once you've decided what you want them to do as a result, that will have an influence on actually what you write. They say that content is king, but the audience is ace. The most important thing is, who are you writing for? You've got your content. You know your content. You know it better than anybody else. And sometimes that's part of the problem. You know it too closely. I've always thought that I should think, I'm writing for my mother or your aunt or your friend, somebody who doesn't know a great deal about it. So you really need to understand what their different needs are. You're writing for a journalist, particularly a Brussels-based journalist. He may be specialized in the subject, so he may know a lot. He might be the environment correspondent or the IT correspondent. So he'll know a lot and you can go into quite a lot of detail. It might be an MEP. Now, they may sit on a particular committee, so they might know the area that you're talking about. But you must remember that they work on an awful lot of things. They see a lot of people. So don't assume that people know things just because they sit on the right committee or they have a certain title. If you're talking to a commissioner, he's going to have a much more top line, much more objective view of something than a desk officer who really knows the nitty gritty of things, really knows the detail. They all have different needs and your job is to get them the information you need. Don't write for yourself. And dare I say it, don't write for your client. If I wrote what my clients wanted me to write all the time, we wouldn't have a successful communication because the clients want to go into far too much detail. And there's something that I go into later, which is that you have to talk about what it means, not just the detail, but what you want the person to do with it. And that often is not putting all the detail in. Say the most important thing first and say it clearly. So you could have a strong heading, you could have a strong subheading, or you could just have a strong opening paragraph. But the opening paragraph cannot be going backwards, it cannot be saying in the context of this, that is a commission statement. Don't write like the commission themselves. Personally, I always have what I want pretty much in the heading and then a subheading giving a bit of background. Then the introduction will have the same. And then perhaps para 2 or 3 might give a little bit of background, here in Spain, here in Germany, to tailor it a little bit. And then the rest of it is just some detail. The story should come up front because that's what people will look at, and that is what will make them decide whether they're going to read further. Personally, I always say to my clients and to people I work with, not to focus on the what, there will be a conference on Thursday or whatever it is, but to focus on the so what. What does it mean? So, for example, if we are saying that Europe needs to recycle more plastic bottles, why? Why do we need to recycle plastic bottles? We have the opportunity to move to a circular economy. We have the opportunity to be net neutral by 2030 or whatever it is. Talk about the so what and what it means and what the consequences are. And that will bring the audience in, and that will interest them to read further. Don't expect the reader to know what's important. For me, this is quite an important point, because often in Brussels, you're starting at quite a high level of knowledge. So that's why you really have to tailor it. If this is an MEP sitting on a particular committee who has sat through the first and second reading, then probably they know what you're talking about. But if this is an NGO that's just got involved in a subject, don't expect them to know why it's important. To tell them. If you want something, if you want a piece of legislation, if you want some action, if you want a decision in a certain way, then say so. So we need policymakers to focus on training doctors. If that's what you need, then say it. You are not writing Shakespeare. You are not trying to win the Nobel Prize. You are just trying to get information out there to people so that they will understand it. Now, if you were trying to write a novel, or if you were trying to write a piece of prose, or even if you were writing annual report or something, I would expect this to be much more flowing and much more accurate. But if you are not, if you're just writing to get information out, use simple words. And I am English, I know lots of words, but I do try to use simple words when I'm writing English so that everybody understands.
As she said, you begin by considering who your audience is, which determines which platform we're using. So usually we're reaching policymakers through Twitter and LinkedIn. We often reach youth through Instagram, and general audiences could be on any of these. In the last years, we're seeing that Facebook is not as relevant as it used to be. It's being used mostly for personal purposes, but a lot of people are still on it. So I would say don't focus too many resources on Facebook at this point, but what you can do is repost copy that you've drafted for other platforms. Your tone of voice has a lot to do with your organization's own branding, but it's also tailored to your audience. So for policymakers, you would maybe tend to focus on sounding more authoritative and knowledgeable, or maybe highlight your role as a key stakeholder in the sector or the process you're referring to. And for youth, on the other hand, you might want to come across as a bit more chatty and relatable. For social, you always have to keep in mind that you have two goals, actually. One of them is to get people to do whatever it is that you want them to do. And the other is to engage them in conversation. This means that your tone can be a lot more conversational and direct than most other formats that are either in print or based on what has traditionally been in print. An online newsletter, for example, you don't just focus on delivering your message clearly, but also on teasing out that engagement, on provoking a conversation somehow. That's what makes it a little bit different. And what I really want to emphasize more than anything else is that you have literally about half a second to do this. People scroll through their feeds and their attention spans are tiny. You can actually bore them and get them to move on from your post in less than a second. Social media writing just follows the same principles of every other kind of writing, and you just want to cut to the chase, basically. So with social media, you would think this is easy, especially on Twitter, where you only have 280 characters, even less if you include a link, which eats about 23 characters. So you would think it doesn't really leave that much room for fluff. But it's amazing how many people still manage to beat around the bush, even within this 280 word limit. And basically there's a foolproof formula you can follow. You start with a punchy statement to grab attention. I have a few do's and don'ts. So hashtags should be relevant to a larger conversation. You're really using this to be part of the conversation on Twitter. It shouldn't be a gratuitous thing. It's not to be cute. So I'm not going to go into the whole science of hashtagging right now. There's definitely people who are more expert on that than I am, but just to relate this directly to good writing, hashtags can really clutter up your text and kind of, stall the flow of the post and kind of annoy people. So I would just say use them strategically and sparingly. Think about what's really relevant. Definitely also if there's an event, something like that, you want to get in on the momentum of that. So make sure you have the right one that most people are using. And here you have some examples of random hashtags that just kind of clutter up people's posts and don't really serve a purpose. First of all, it's amazing how many organizations don't clearly explain their mission on their websites. I've spent up to half an hour on people's websites and I still could not tell you what they do exactly. So that has to be really clear right away. People should really know what you do within about 30 seconds. So I would use a clear tagline on the homepage and include a really short and concise about us that puts it in concrete terms to begin with. But I guess the main point is don't overdo it on text or put, for example, your entire company history. I don't think it's really necessary, but just follow the clear writing guidelines that Sam shared and keep it simple.
As a writer, as an author, I don't think it's generally helpful to start any form of communication by deliberately excluding people from your communication. I think that's especially so when the bubble you are talking about contains the institutions of a democracy. Because all it does is lay you open to accusations of elitism. And in turn, all that does is fan the fires of populism. I'm not going to disagree. Obviously, knowing who you're writing to is important, yeah? But I believe what is every bit as important is knowing who is doing the talking, yeah? Now, that's not the same as writing for your client. Let me just go to the first chart and I'll explain what that means. The purpose of any communication is clearly to be known, hopefully to be trusted, and maybe even to be liked, yeah? I believe you simply cannot do that. You simply cannot be known to others until you know yourself, yeah? It's a bit like relationship counselors. You can't be loved until you love yourself, all that stuff. Before doing anything, I would say to everybody in this room, before doing any form of communication, yeah, on behalf of your organization, put a mirror up to your organization and be brutally honest with yourself. Who are you? When I make this presentation, people say, well, I don't need to distinguish myself. I'm unique. I represent the cardboard box manufacturers of Europe and nobody else does. Therefore, I don't need to distinguish myself from anybody else. But the fact of the matter is that everybody communicating in the bubble or outside it is competing with everybody else doing the same. You are competing for share of voice and share of mind. And you will never achieve either if you appear to be exactly the same as everybody else and you say exactly the same as everybody else, yeah? So you need a very clear, either a positioning or a proposition. All communication is a form of stimulus and response. And the single biggest mistake made, and not only in the bubble, it's made everywhere, is for communicators to give the response, not the stimulus. And the best example I've ever heard of that is imagine if the first words I'd said to you all this afternoon was, I'm a very modest person. Your response is the opposite of what I want. I've made the mistake of giving you the response rather than giving you a stimulus which evokes that response. Yeah. Communication works on a ladder. From knowledge, thoughts, and feelings. And the higher you can start on that ladder, the more effective your communication is. Example, the meeting is at 3:00. As in, I've imparted knowledge, yeah? Can you make a 3 o'clock meeting? I've engaged you in thought about your agenda. If you can make the 3 o'clock meeting, there's going to be cake. I've made you feel about reorganizing your agenda. I don't agree. Yes, I agree and I disagree. Write in short sentences, yes, but not always, no? This sentence has 5 words. Here are more 5 words, 5 more words. 5 word sentences are fine. You see what's happening? It becomes monotonous. Listen to it, vary sentence length, yeah? Once you've got your reader's attention, you can have huge, long sentences. Write music. Try not to write words, try to write music, yeah? Use a sound that is pleasing to the reader's ear. Why am I showing you a picture of three middle-aged men laughing? I'm going to tell you who they are. From the left, David Abbott, Peter Mead, Adrian Vickers. Many years ago, they formed an ad agency. And I was lucky enough to work there for 6 years as it became the biggest ad agency in Britain, and which it carried on doing for 20 years. But I don't want to really talk about them. I want you to look at what they're doing. They're having fun. Yeah. And that's really my last appeal, is that don't say, writer, communicator, advocate, whatever, don't save all your fun up for Friday. You're allowed to have fun while you do. I think writing is one of the best jobs in the world. I'm so privileged to earn my living as a writer because it's fun. Enjoy it.
It's not that just I'm not a native speaker, I'm not a writer at all. So these tools help me not just avoid grammatical errors, but also many, many other things that I'm going to share with you. So the first one, I think we all know and probably use this one, Grammarly. I don't think there's need to go in depth in how it's used. We all know there are plugins. You can have it in your browser. You can go to the website. You can have it on your phone and everything else. One more thing. As a non-native speaker, as like I am, are you sure you can always trust it? If you pay attention to the screenshot yes. on the right, I've taken those from Grammarly's website. I've taken their own copy and checked it with their own tool. And these are the mistakes. So they don't even trust themselves that much. Okay, I'm fortunate enough to have Maya and Sam check my copy and check my writing and do their own. But I wouldn't use Grammarly that much as a crutch. What I like about it is, I think, as I've said, I'm not a writer, I'm not a native speaker, I'm not from the Brussels bubble, and I'm guessing that this is true for a lot of people here. So there are certain things that you do not pick up on, and one thing that Grammarly tells you, it gives you a tiny little emoji in the bottom of your text, it gives you your tone. This is something I'm not always completely sensitive to. Sometimes I'll miss the tone, sometimes maybe it will sound a bit aggressive or rude, we don't want that. But there's something even better than Grammarly for this. And it's called the Hemingway app. So this is my homepage at this point. This is the one thing I use, especially if you have a Grammarly plugin in your, I use a Chrome browser, I have a Grammarly plugin. So it simultaneously checks this text as I do it. So, you know, two for the price of one. I don't know if many of you remember the story, but Hemingway famously spent biggest part of the 1920s in Paris as a correspondent for the, I think it was Toronto Daily Star. And at that time, the thing they started using massively was telegram. So he had a chance to, instead of writing, you know, long letters that would take time and time to reach Toronto from Paris, he started using telegram, and he had to crafting his skill better in writing short sentences and being to the point. Now, it had to be a perfect piece of news. It had to be like Twitter is today. And he often said that him using Telegram as a young man and as a young reporter actually made him the writer he was. So you can use, it's called Hemingway app. It's easy to find. For a lot of us non-native speakers, because your concept and your idea about what you're talking is far above of your command of a foreign language usually. So we all tend to, I know I do, we tend to over-explain. And that's a horrible, horrible trap. That's where we get into problems that Sam talked about and Maya talked about. You go on rambling, the language becomes confusing and difficult to read. So what Hemingway app does, it marks your texts and gives you, you can see here, like readability grade 15. Okay, aim for lower. Aim, as they say, you know, explain it to me like I'm five. So this is what we're going for. If you copy in a piece of text you find like on a commission website or something, it will give you a horrible score, a horrible, horrible score. It will tell you like, please no, like make this just two sentences. Actually the text I've used here is also from Grammarly's website. I don't know why I have it in for them today, but apparently I do. So you can see the score that the Grammarly got themselves. All bright red, meaning you can see it on the right side, meaning 7 out of 10 sentences are extremely hard to read. Sometimes you get a few yellow ones saying, okay, maybe if you're kind of difficult, tone it down. Don't use too many. This kind of gives you also the Hemingway style. So it tells you don't overuse passive voice. Don't use too many adverbs, use active voices, everything. And sometimes gives you kind of a little hint. It gives you, when you hover over these blue highlights, it will just tell you, like, make it stronger. This is weak. Don't say, we might want to. Say, we're going to. You know, be a Hemingway when you write.